Members, this is the appointed time and we have a quorum, so I call this meeting to order.
或者请这个官员。
Let's invite the administration in, but before they come in, I'd like to remind members attending this meeting that if there is any direct or indirect pecuniary interest in relation to this bill, before you speak, please disclose the nature of the interest. According to Rule 83A of the ROP, let me declare the interest. I would like to disclose my interest in relation to tourism industry. I am a remunerated director of a travel agency, and in terms of 9 tourist-related associations, I am also a remunerated executive director and member. For details, please refer to the relevant paper. This paper already contained information that I just cited. It's available on the LegCo's website. May I welcome the administration to our meeting. I won't go through the attendance list. We've had a number of meetings already. So perhaps I should invite the administration to respond to matters arising from the last meeting. Please walk us through the paper. Thank you, Chairman. About issues raised at the last meeting by members, we have already provided a paper to respond to these matters. That is CB bracket 4468/1718/02. And we responded to matters raised by members at the last meeting. Let me just touch on one or two salient points, which are quite technical. And for other points, I won't go through them. These are mostly discussions arising from the last meeting. First, I'd like to go through paragraphs 2 to 7 of the paper with members, relating to matters on carrying on travel agent business, about certain requirements in relation to the premises, staffing, and the capital requirement. We reviewed the relevant requirement after our discussion last time. And in fact, we have drawn reference from the requirements currently imposed by the TIC, Travel Industry Council of Hong Kong, and we follow the requirement on the premises. For example, paragraph 5A of the paper provides that the premises should be situated within a commercial building and there should be separate and independent access open to the public. We call it the open business location, and there is also capital requirement. For staffing requirement at each premises, there must be at least 2 staff members, one of which should have a minimum of 2 consecutive years of experience of the travel industry within 5 years before the commencement of the post. The other should be a full-time staff member. And having regard to technological advances, consumers nowadays do not just buy travel products in person at physical shops, and very often they would deal with travel agents online. And in order to make sure that the bill catches up with the time, and we set out in paragraph 6.8.2c our proposed relaxations to the requirements. For example, the requirement that the premises is suitable for travel agent business, staffing requirement, and also branch capital requirement. Paragraph 7 sets out our proposed revised arrangements. Very briefly, the travel agent can of course choose whether to carry on a travel agent business at a local open business location. And if so, the applicant must inform the travel industry authority TIA in the application and seek approval. But of course, the agent may also choose not to operate the business at a local open business location, but say on a website, as long as one operates a travel business, there should be a correspondence address with the permission of the TIA. Of course, any change of address should also be subject to approval by the TIA. So in future, the requirement that the premises is suitable for a travel agent business will no longer be an open business location with direct access provided to the general public. So, however, if a travel agent would like to operate business at an open business location as well as a non-open business location, one can still do so subject to permission by the TIA. Let's say if a travel agency might initially operate a website and may later choose to operate at a local business location, this can be done with approval by the TIA. For travel agents operating the business via a website or through electronic means, at the moment, we require a license to be displayed at a physical location. But if the business is done through electronic means, then similarly, on the website, the license number should be displayed on the website to identify the travel agency. So that's about relaxing the requirement on premises. That concludes my explanation of the paper. Thank you. I'd like to pick up on the administration's paper. First of all, about this revision, it is a major revision. Say, if an agency carries out a transaction electronically, if there is no contact point, no business location, physically speaking, my understanding is that now exemption will be given. And you may know that in Hong Kong, many travel agencies do not operate at an open local business location. The agency could operate through the telephone or the internet. So in future, as long as they inform the TIA that they would not be facing the general public, but rather carry out transactions through other means, such as by telephone, etc., does it mean that after the revision has been made, the travel agent will not be required to operate in the premises in the commercial building? As long as the applicant pays a guarantee and also provides an address and a bank account, that will do. Thank you, Chairman. Now, the regulatory regime in the bill is a comprehensive one. In terms of the mode of operation, we need to catch up with the times, but the requirements remain consistent. For example, when a travel agent applies for a license, that we still have the fit and proper person requirement. And since 2011, we have increased the threshold for travel agent business. We have added the requirement on the guarantee to be provided, and there should be an authorized representative responsible for the operation of the travel agent business. All these requirements remain. Our consideration is that because of technological advances and the mode of consumption by consumers, we see room for relaxing the requirement on the premises. This is how we will go about it. As for the travel agency, it's up to them whether to choose to operate physically at a local open business location or just online or both. This is a commercial decision. At the time of application, for example, if the travel agent already informed the TIA the mode of operation, and if there is a change of the mode of operation, then advance application should be made with the TIA for approval first. Some members have been suggesting that there are new operators doing business on the internet only, and there are also young people having startup businesses. They may not have the resources sufficient enough for the traditional mode, and if we could provide more flexibility on the requirement on premises and staffing, it will facilitate their business. Let's say instead of using the internet, transactions are made via the phone or even via WhatsApp on a mobile phone? Does it fall into the arena of online transactions? We do not specify what mode of transaction it is, whether it's by telephone or by the internet. As long as there is the provision of a correspondence address, it should be subject to our vetting, and at the time of license application, it may be necessary to interview the applicant. Information will also have to be provided by the applicant so that the authority will be satisfied that the applicant is a fit and proper person and the requirements will be met, and a bank guarantee should also be provided. There should also be a fit and proper qualified authorized representative so as to regulate the business. So the applicant should be a fit and proper person. You cannot just find a contact point with an address. No. For authorized representative, as we explained before, in terms of education and other matters, we have relevant requirements. And the person will take up the responsibility of managing the travel agent business. We understand for existing travel agencies, during the transition period, they will not be required to pay the bank guarantee. What about those operating in a new mode on the internet? For existing ones, as we explained before, no bank guarantee is required. So what about electronic transactions? When operators have only a correspondence address but no physical business location, what happens? Then one will have to pay the bank guarantee. But this is not allowed under the existing law. Right. Any questions? Mr. Wu. I'm sorry. Let's start with Mr. Pun Siu-Peng. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to pursue this point. We talked about the premises requirement, capital, as well as staffing requirement. And I'd like to talk about the staffing requirement. At each premises, there must be at least one manager with a minimum of 2 consecutive years' experience of the travel industry within 5 years before the relevant application, and one full-time staff member. Now, I want to know whether the manager should be a full-time staff, and also for the full-time staff member, no experience requirement, right? Thank you, Mr. Poon, for the question. As I understand, this is the existing TIC's requirement. My understanding is that both staff members should work full-time. But as we explained just now, there will be a relaxation of the staffing requirement. How flexible will it be? The manager should come with experience, not the full-time staff member, right? Mr. Poon, thank you for your question. Your understanding is correct. This is the existing requirement of the Travel Industry Council on staffing. And it is true that the manager should have experience. For the other staff member, no experience of the travel industry is required. And I'd like to point out that for the staffing requirement, this is the minimum requirement imposed by the TIC, and that's the existing approach. As explained in the paper, we've considered the consumer's mode of consumption and the mode of operation and technological advances. We believe that more flexibility should be given to the travel agencies for them to decide on the staffing arrangements. So we propose to relax that as well. Next, Mr. Wuchiwai.
Thank you, Chairman. I just want to clarify one thing. Is it that whether it's a newly opened business or a traditional business, that as long as I comply with the requirements, I can have online business? And if the online business, you know, traditionally speaking, the traditional business can transition into the online model, right? That is not to be combine or have to comply with the premises and staffing requirements, but we only need to make the application to TIA, is that right? Yes, your understanding is correct. That is for a new travel agent to be set up, as long as they comply with the capital requirement, guarantee money requirement, and the authorized representative requirement, then it can operate. And doesn't matter whether it's got a physical shop or is it operating online. For the premises, we don't have any particular requirement. I welcome this sort of adjustment because this is, you know, to prepare for what's likely to happen in the future, right? You know, the trend, that there could be, you know, the new trend of online shops in the travel industry. In the paper, there's no detail on, not many details provided, but would you provide us with a markup so we can have a better idea of the amendments? Yes. Actually, we are telling you our directions, and in the markup copy, there will be the amendments included on premises and staffing requirement. And then you will see, you know, the details there. Thank you, in writing. Okay. Item 2 in the paper about the principles for being exempted from getting a license. Normally speaking, for a company, if you work for another company that does not have a license, but for travel business, you know, there could be liable penalties. And yet in the paper paragraph 1, seems like there shouldn't be any problem. I just want to get a clearer answer from you. Is that the early principle is that you have to look at the nature of a business, whether it's got the frequencies of transactions and so forth. But the way that the paper is written seems like you don't really emphasize that criteria that much. You're just saying that as long as the company is ancillary to its principal business, then the company is not considered carrying on travel agent business and would not be required to hold a travel agent license. Can you elaborate more on this point? Are you talking about paragraph 2? Yes. Paragraph 2 in the paper. Yes. It is a brief explanation here in paragraph 2 because it's explaining clause 4. Basically, in the bill, clause 4, it provides for the meaning of carry on travel agent business. And clause 4, bracket 1, sets out the business activities concerned. And clause 4, bracket 3, sets out the relevant in principle considerations. That is, if a company's main business is not, as mentioned in it's not in the travel agent business as stipulated in clause 4. So, and if it involves business related to travel agent, but it's only ancillary to the company's principal business, then according to this clause, the company is not considered to carry on travel agent business. And in the bill, as Chairman said, there are principles mentioned, or principal considerations mentioned. And I think that the considerations has fully reflected the court's criteria used by the courts. So the most important is you have to know the whole truth. It's not that you call yourself a travel company, then you can be bound or not bound by this definition of carrying on travel agent business. We need to consider the whole truth. And also considering whether how frequent your travel business is, how often is it conducted, and whether it's a core business of a company, and contributions to the financial status of a company. So we have to look at all the considerations, and then up to the court to decide what sort of business it should be defined as. And the TIA can also, in the future, based on the court's past judgments, make reference and let the public know for reference. So you are still in keeping with the original principles. Yes, there are no differences. Yeah, we are abiding by the same principles. Okay, paragraph 8 in the paper. As for the misleading information and so forth, that is in the same transaction, in the same tour, but there are different transactions for the same tour, then there will need to be administrative measures formulated by TIA. But in the bill, would you make corresponding changes? Because in the paragraph, you talk about mean measures. But how about you know, considering the offense of misleading omission? But how would you consider it? Is it considered a criminal offense? I think in the paper it confirms once again that we will not treat it as a criminal offense. Later on, when we begin the clause by clause scrutiny, we will give you more details. Thank you. Paragraph 10 of the paper. It says that for the mean measure, if the customs department find problems with the agent's compliance with the ME measure, even if you have complied fully, the customs department can also initiate proceedings if they think that you haven't done enough and you need to provide the proof. What sort of proof are you talking about? Is it that when litigations occur, the customs department will ask you to provide the proof they need to see? So what do you mean by proof? Okay, I think the proof is mainly about proof that they have complied with the admin measure. But of course, we cannot rule out the possibility that in some cases there could be exceptional circumstances. So therefore, for individual cases, it will be really determined on the merits of each case. We can't really foresee here whether other law enforcement agencies would require other kinds of proof. Okay, so because, you know, talking about proof, you know, you need to be very clear, you know, in case of legal proceedings. Okay, and for the subsidiary legislation, the annex, is it that are they all for negative vetting? Are they all supposed to be for negative vetting? They're all for negative vetting, all subsidiary legislations, yes. So including all the amendments in the list there, yes, in the paper, yes. So one more question. Yeah, 170 amendment of schedules. By the time comes for the subsidiary legislation, according to electrical rules, we need like 21 days and 21 other extension period, 21 day of extension period, and 28 days plus 21 of days of extension. Is that enough? If it's not enough, what can we do? Because I'm just worried that we may not have the time, enough time. Maybe the Department of Justice or you can give opinions. Thank you. For the subsidiary legislation, of course, because TIA is new, so there will be a lot more subsidiary legislations required for it. But we'll make reference to Cap 218, the subsidiary legislations under that chapter. As for individual items, if needed, if there's a need to set up subsidiary legislations after the TIA is set up, which requires public consultation and also consultation with LegCo, then we'll follow the procedure. And then only have we done that, then will we submit the legislation to LegCo for scrutiny. Supplement to Chairman, as the administration just said, for developing subsidiary legislation, if it's a complex one, then I think they can first consult the panel first. And the panel can arrange for public hearings to collect public views. So we can go to the panel first, okay. Last question. About in the list, 150, page 8. You know, travel agents, whenever there are incidents that happen to a customer, and often the travel agents will need to, you know, should an accident or incident happen, the travel agents will pay for the relatives to go to the destination where the incident happened first, or to help the family deal with, you know, funeral matters or whatever, you know, pay, make advance payments. And based on the 150 regulations, you said that in the future there could be authorization. But how are you going to, by way of subsidiary legislation, try to avoid the travel agents making advance payments and not being reimbursed later on? Actually, on page 9 of our paper, about 150 regulations, bracket 4, 4AB and C, actually it details the measures. As Chairman just mentioned, before a customer departs for a destination, before they depart from Hong Kong, there can be an authorization to apply for express payment in respect of an outbound traveler facing death or accidents during the trip. So particularly if the traveler dies in an accident or lost their mental capacity, then the authorization will make it easier for the agent to deal with the matter. In the main legislation, the authorization is provided for, and in 150 bracket 5, in order to allow for this, we actually can, in the subsidiary legislation, make further regulations to deal with the procedures concerned. That will be covered in the subsidiary legislation. I think basically, I think that's all the questions I have for the paper. Any other questions, members? If not, then we go to clause by clause scrutiny. Okay, just a minor point. Page 2. About premises requirement for the travel agent. That is, they must be in commercial premises and buildings. But, sorry, commercial buildings, what is the definition of it? Is it a definition in the land lease?
Yeah.
Well, because we do have composite buildings in which travel agencies operate. It's a residential commercial composite building. Does it count? That is the requirement of the TIC. Our understanding is that the use of the premise, intended use of premises, should be considered. But does it follow the land lease or the DMC, deed of mutual covenant? Because when it comes to mixed-use building, the idea used to be that the composite building also counts. But then there are buildings where some floors would be for residential, some floors for commercial. I understand that it's quite common that travel agencies nowadays operate in aged composite buildings. I want to know whether their status would be affected, such that they would be inadvertently caught by the law. Thank you, Mr. Wu, for the question. According to the TIC's provisions, they approve premises operating in both kinds of premises. So we have separate and independent commercial premises, stroke buildings. So you can operate in the premises of a commercial building as long as the interior design of the building shows that it is solely for a commercial operation related to the travel industry. So both practices are captured. Like Mr. Wu said. And anyhow, our proposed regulation is a relaxed version. Of course, the operator may choose to operate at the physical location, but it's no longer a mandatory requirement. But it's about application for a travel agent license. Oh, that means as long as the capital requirement is met, even if the registered premises is a residential one, this will also do? Correct. There should be a correspondence address. I'm talking about the existing requirement. Well, let Mr. Ao explain. He's responsible for approving licenses. I'll see if Mr. Ao has anything to add. The Travel Industry Council at the moment oversees this exercise. The TIC would inspect the premises, and like Mr. Liu explained just now, it should be a commercial premises or buildings, and the TIC does inspections. We impose a similar requirement, but more importantly, once a license is granted, that means the applicant would have passed the inspection process, and the license will be issued according to the particulars provided by the applicant. Mr. Wu is suggesting that there are some travel agents not operating in a commercial premises. They obtain licenses at the moment. They'd like to know whether they must remain in the commercial premises before they get a license in the future, because my understanding is that sometimes travel agents operate their business at home. Because we have a requirement on the premises, it should be accessible by the public, and that's the existing approach. In future, this requirement will be scrapped. As explained by Mr. Liu, if it receives business from the public, it will need to apply for a license in advance, and the license has to be displayed in the premises. Otherwise, a correspondence address is needed, depending on the mode of operation. My question, therefore, is this. If I choose the latter, that I operate my business without a physical location, does it mean that as an applicant, I can use my home address as the correspondence address? As long as I meet the capital requirement and the payment of a bank guarantee and other requirements you mentioned, fit and proper person, as long as these two requirements are met, I can operate my business at home. Yes, in principle, as long as the TIA receives an advance application and the TIA approves it. So as a licensee, when I sell my products, I need to affix a chop on the product, the receipt I give to the consumer to make sure that these buyers are protected. Thank you, Mr. Wu, for the question. As explained just now, although you may not have a physical business location, thereby no requirement on display of license physically. Say if you operate on a website, you still need to display your license number. And in terms of communicating with your customers, you still need to display the license number of your travel agency. The details may not be set out in the principal ordinance, but in the administrative guidelines, they will be set out similar to the TIC's existing approach. Let's say if I work with a travel agent in selling some tourism products, well, here, and I'm referring to paragraph 3, that if I cooperate with a travel agent, will I be subject to the same premises requirement? No? No. Well, if the travel agent has decided to operate this business on a website, there is no premises requirements applicable. I'm referring to travel agents with a physical business location. Say, I work with companies ABC to sell my products. Now, as far as the concept is concerned, it is a branch. Because of this sale arrangement, is it still all right, even if I don't declare this as a branch? Thank you, Mr. Wu. At the last meeting, we also explained that there is much flexibility here. As long as the travel agent works with another company, which may not be another travel agency, as long as on the documents, things are clear with the customers, and the receipts, invoices issued carry the title of the travel agent, that will do. We're not suggesting that transactions can only be carried out on the premises with the address as provided by the travel agent. This is never the requirement. So you can entrust a travel agent to do it, as long as you know the company so entrusted issues a receipt with the title of the travel agent, the license number, correspondence address, etc. That will do. But if a travel agent engages a company in, say, receiving customers or helping with this business, is a declaration necessary? No declaration is needed. Thank you, Chairman. However, but at the time of applying for a license with the TIA, if there is an open local business location accessible to the general public, and if the travel agent would like to operate at another location, this is an addition or a change, and this should be related to the TIA in advance. I'm sorry, Chairman. Of course, if the travel agent operates a branch, he must inform the TIA, right? I understand that. I was referring to another scenario. A travel agent may engage in cooperation with a company, with another organization, in selling its products. I want to know whether this would be subject to registration. No. All clear? Before we move on to the clause-by-clause examination of the bill, today I received some proposed CSAs from Mr. Michael Look, and I'm going to deal with them this way. For the government CSAs and CSAs from members, these will be discussed after the clause-by-clause scrutiny has been completed. Otherwise, you may submit CSAs at different times, and we should deal with all of them in one go. So unless there is objection, this is how I'm going to deal with them. Let's continue with the clause by clause. Would the government please walk us through? We stopped at clause 4, is that right? Maybe Assistant Commissioner Mr. Lee can help us with the clause by clause process. We are on clause 4, subclause 4, which is about the meaning of carrying on a travel agent business. And this covers four scenarios. Thereby, we have four subclauses. This is modeled on 4 and 4A of CAP 218. For 41A, two scenarios are covered under 4.1, that is, for cross-boundary transport service, outbound and inbound, and that is 4.1A, Roman letter 1 and 3. And if the person operates a means of transport, the person will not be regarded as a travel agent. And that's the first scenario. Second scenario, about 1A2, that is accommodation at a place outside Hong Kong. If the person obtains for another person accommodation at a place outside Hong Kong for occupation over 14 days, then such a person would not be regarded as carrying on travel agent business. Next point is about C. I'm sorry, B, why is it 14 days? It says here to be occupied by that other person for more than 14 days. That is the existing practice. For accommodation for tourists, normally it would be less than 14 days. Anything that goes more than 14 days would be deemed as leasing of properties. And this is a long-standing requirement. Also, the provision in Cap 218. However, for the guest house and accommodation ordinance, it is 28 days. If it's fewer than 28 days, then you should apply for a license as a guest house. Otherwise, it is a normal accommodation for leasing. I think that this is not consistent with the existing guest house and accommodation ordinance. Well, this ordinance has been operated smoothly since 1985. The same requirement has been put in place. We have not received any complaints or difficulties in relation to how this provision operates. But it's a matter of principle. If you lease a hotel room, a guest house, and also accommodation, you have clear definitions. It's not just about the existing practice. I think you should discuss with the Department of Justice. Of course, it's all right for me. But if the other ordinance says 28 days, and if you provide 14 days here, I see the inconsistency. I see there is room for change. Since you're revamping the ordinance, is it necessary to change it to 28 days instead? Thank you, Chairman. We'll go back and have a look. If we expand the regulatory scope from 14 to 28 days, we might be capturing cases not directly related to the tourism industry. They may be caught by our regulatory framework as well. We need to be careful, because when it comes to the travel industry, it's very rare that we have a visitor staying for more than 14 days. Say in a hotel accommodation. For those staying for more than 14 days, usually it would be like a service apartment or a leasing arrangement. And we have not received any views that it is problematic. We need to be very careful about this. Please do go back and consider it, because it also you also need to dovetail this one with the guest house and accommodations ordinance. They have a clear definition. Why is it that for a hotel or for a residential unit, if you want to make it available for lease? Well, the difference is that you can rent a hotel room for just one day, definitely less than 28 days. Whereas for a residential unit, you can lease it for a longer term. For a hotel room, you need to get a license if you want to rent it out for just one day. Then you need to increase the penalty correspondingly. Please go back and think about it. You don't have to answer me today. You need to explain your justification more clearly. It's not just a matter of practice. That won't do. Thank you, Chairman. We'll go back and prepare our response. But I'm not suggesting that this is the existing practice. It is also backed by rationale, and we previously explained to the Legislative Council as well. All along, the regulatory effort has achieved result. And next time, we can give you a response. All right, please do.
Thank you, Chairman. I think what's more important is that we have the guest house ordinance, and there could be other related ordinances as well. I think we should maybe list out all these related provisions. And secondly, 28-day use it to define whether a premises should be governed by the guest house ordinance or what. That's how you draw the line. But here, the 14 days line is drawn. That is, those things under 14 days will be covered or governed by TIA. So I'd like to ask you, is it that you've never seen within the scope of new terms of reference of TIA any products that have more than 15 days or at least 15 days? Deputy Commissioner, it's difficult to say whether there aren't any such products, but the purpose of monitoring, then there needs to be a line drawn. I can give you a reply next time. Yeah, I just want to tell you my observation. I feel that the average tourism product, I think 14 days should be enough. If not, you know, the person may come back and leave and come back again, come back and forth over a period of time. He wouldn't be here for more than 14 days continuously. My question is, if there are products that last more than 14 days, assuming that there is such a product, and yet it's not covered in the business, so with this sort of product, where can we see the protection for them? Deputy Commissioner, I think even if we're targeting, of course, the travel agents in the scope of work of TIA, so it's not so much tourism products that we are targeting at. Will there be a product that only offer accommodation of more than 14 days? Well, based on the current provision, maybe that product would not be covered by the ordinance. But there could be a company that provides all sorts of products, and there could be a chance when a product, of course, in one of its businesses covers more than 30 days. But if that's the case, then that company can still be governed by the ordinance or the bill now. But we hope to see more tourists staying in Hong Kong for longer than the average of 3-point-something days. So if a person stay for 14 days or a longer period, of course, we welcome that. But it won't be because of individual product that is more than 14 days that it can get away with being regulated. I think the chances are very low, I think, because the travel agent will offer all kinds of products. Let me make it clear again. Product that covers more than 14 days is sold. And yet, it still needs to provide the exam. Well, okay, I'm assuming that it will have to pay for the exam as a travel agent. Okay, and the exam is put on and the product is sold. Even if it's a product of more than 15 days, accommodation under 3+2, so will that stamp be enough to cover, or would it be excluded? What is the two-tier coverage? Thank you. Please continue. Okay, the previous two paragraphs talk about outbound travel, and C and D covers inbound tour. And 1A4 covers accommodation, so outbound and inbound tour, and the accommodation is for tourists staying here for 14 days in paragraph C, and D is related to sightseeing. That is A5 covers sightseeing, and it talks about the operators and the people enjoying the services. That is the operators and owners of the sightseeing services. They would not be regarded as people operating the travel agents. That's the conditions described here. Okay. And then talks about the meaning of inbound tour group business. A person carries on mainland inbound tour group business if the person obtains any of the following services for mainland inbound tour group organized for a person in the mainland. Here on CB bracket 41333/1617 bracket 02, the paper actually points out the provisions based on members' views. We would actually make amendments to the provision here to make our meanings clearer. As I said, the mainland, a person in the mainland will be changed to businesses. In English, will be carrying on the business of organizing mainland inbound tour groups. So there will be an amendment in this paragraph, and we will provide the writing later on. And there are four parts here. Mr. Lee, on the interpretation, when we talked about it last time, the tour, definition of tour, based on the interpretation, is that two people can form a tour. Well, I think we'll elaborate on it later on. That is, if there are two couples asking a travel agent to book for them just a hotel and also urban transport. That's it. And if you define tour as one of two people only, then many people would be qualified as forming a tour. So I think there could be potential problems here because your scope is too broad. So the number of people forming a tour, according in the interpretation, can you set a standard that would actually provide more convincing definition? Mr. Lee. As for mainland inbound tour, the definition here is talking about mainland travel agents, you know, organizing inbound tour groups. We have discussed the issue with China National Tourism Administration, and tours organized by mainland tour travel agents, and the definition of the people for a tour. But in the mainland, there isn't such a definition for a tour. But in our amendment, the scope will be narrowed. That is, to mainland travel agents or tours organized by mainland travel agents. So the most important is that it has to be a mainland travel agent that organizes the tour, and which is approved by the CNTA. So that will make it clear. That is, if there is a tour organized by a mainland travel agent and being accredited by the CNTA, that would be in line with the definition here. I think that's clearer rather than defining it on the basis of the number of members. Because under the mainland tourism law, there isn't a line drawn for the number of people in the tour. So therefore, we should, I think, follow that. So in your interpretation, are you prepared to make any changes? Because here it says that it means tour means there are two or more people involved. Yes, thank you, Chairman. We'll make an adjustment. That is, when we have the clause-by-clause scrutiny, we will explain. Yes, we will do that, yes, in interpretation. Because based on this definition, whether it is two people or not, you know, whoever comes to me, I will need to deal with it as a tour. Mr. Wu? Okay, clarification. It is very popular now for people to have just a package for hotel and accommodation and airline tickets. So if I ask ABC Tour on the mainland to book a tour to Hong Kong for accommodation and transportation arrangement only. So that is 3+2, but that's also a popular package on the mainland, right? And would that be covered by the law? Thank you. I think in the mainland, of course, I'm sure it's still very popular for people to come on tours. For tours, travel tours, they would be actually more related to this piece of legislation. But if they're coming on their own, just having booked their airline ticket and accommodation alone, and travel agents on the mainland do provide that sort of arrangements for them. But if they come to Hong Kong on tours organized by mainland travel agents, then that, of course, would be regarded as group tours. So I think there will be a difference or differentiation made between group and private tours. As for inbound tours, here in this section, this mainly is intended to regulate group tours. So therefore, there is the need for regulation in this bill. As for the individual tourists, there isn't any any problems or potential problems with people coming in on tours that charge zero fee. So they're not really covered. So legally speaking, you are talking about at least two people coming to Hong Kong on the tour, and then they will be governed by this piece of legislation, right? So for individual tourists, they would buy 3+2 of the 3+2 services from a travel agent. Would they be considered as tours still, group tours still? I just have a question mark over that. But having heard from the Deputy Commissioner just then, I think that in terms of the drafting, maybe you should actually make it clearer in your writing so that it's clear that we are trying to regulate tours that charge zero fees. But for individual tourists that only buy airline tickets and accommodation arrangement here, so that there shouldn't be any worries about that. So, Commissioner, you said that in the interpretation you will have a clearer definition, right? They would adjust the wordings in the interpretation. Yeah, at the next meeting, please. I thought you only adjust the number. Signing, yeah, as you mentioned, is also important. Who signed it? That is besides the travel agents getting, when it gets an order, you have to define the definition of the tours. Talk about signing. What sort of signing? Is it signing by mainland L, a party called L, or a mainland party, or any other signings that would help you differentiate between group tours and other tours? As I just explained, in the interpretation, when we go through the amendments, I will go through with you the changes. And the direction, however, is that we would mention that will have to be the mainland travel agents that organize the mainland tours in line with the requirement of the CNTA.
So next time, please provide an answer in your response paper, so that you won't delay the CSA's issue. Let's continue with Clause 5. There are four parts to Clause 5. As mentioned just now, a person obtains any of the following services for mainland inbound tour group, so on and so forth. And there are four kinds of services that comes from Cap 218A, Section 18. 5A, a service providing sightseeing or visits to local places of interest. B, a service providing restaurant meals or other catered meals. C, a service providing shopping trips. And D, a service providing the three kinds I mentioned. Local transport in connection with any of the services described in paragraphs A, B, and C. And if these four are met, it will be regarded as operating mainland inbound tour group business. And then next, Division 2, prohibitions. We have Clause 6, prohibitions. There are six sub-clauses. The first one, there is an origin. Again, it comes from the Section 98 of Cap 218. No person may, without a travel agent license, carry on travel agent business. 6.2. A licensed travel agent must not carry on travel agent business under the following circumstances. And that is also coming from 9BC of Cap 218. And as we explained in paragraph 7 of the paper submitted today, we are going to make an amendment here. At any premises other than the premises specified in the travel agent license, that's 628 I'm reading out, it will not apply to licensees who operate travel agent business at a non-local business location. It only applies to licensees operating at an open local business location directly accessible to the general public. Yes, Mr. Wu, I think he is really confusing. Let me repeat. We mentioned the amendment in the paper. We're going to move an amendment. That is to operate travel agent business at the license at the premises specified in the travel agent license. This will not apply to a travel agent business operating at a non-open local business location. Our amendment is that if a travel agent is permitted to operate at an open business location directly accessible to the public, then the travel agent cannot operate at any premises other than the premises specified in the license. That is, another open business location directly accessible to the general public. That is, you are allowed only to operate at the premises approved by the authority. Sorry, maybe it's a problem with my comprehension. I just want to clarify a few points. First, there is a vocabulary. There is a term right for non-open local business location, because they may operate outside Hong Kong, so they are not operating locally and will not be caught by the law. If you operate locally at a physical business location accessible to the general public, prior approval would be needed. So let's say if you operate in Hong Kong in a physical location, not permitted in the license, then it's prohibited. Then for a premises not open to the public, I can still operate under a license as a travel agent. Mr. Liu, well, coming back to the same point, let me clarify once again. Just now, Mr. Li, the assistant commissioner, was referring to those operating on a physical premises. At the time of application, of course, the TIA's approval will be needed. If you want to operate another branch, or if you want to change the physical location, of course, prior application and approval from the TIA will be required. Now, what if a travel agent cooperates with another company whilst not operating at a open business location? There is no such existing requirement on regulating the transactions. There will not be any regulation in future. So it's a technical point about open local business location. In short, we are referring to a physical location for doing business. Then the TIA must know the address of your open business location. And if your location changes, the TIA should be informed. And that is why prior approval from the TIA should be sought. Say, if the travel agent cooperates with a company or maybe a consumer. There is no such requirement that the consumer must complete the transaction at a certain location. I understand your point, but I just want to make it clear. I ask the question because you're going to move an amendment to relax the requirement. As long as I could pay the bank guarantee, meeting the capital requirement, even without a physical business location, I will still be given a travel agent license. So this will not be dealt with in this clause, right? Which clause? Mr. Lee, let me take Mr. Wu's question. This will be dealt with here, but it is the part about prohibitions. Like Mr. Lee said just now, we are focusing on prohibitions. If you have informed the TIA that you will be operating a business at a certain location, then without notice, without application, you change to another location, then this will be prohibited. So if it's outside the scope of prohibitions and if you are licensed, you can still carry on with the business. Right. Is any explanation needed at all? You're telling us the prohibitions, and for things not prohibited here, you can go on, carry on with them. Well, this will be reflected in detail in the amendment. But here, the prohibitions, we need to be clear because it carries criminal liability. We need to make it clear that if a travel agent conducts business at a business location without the knowledge of TIA, without seeking approval, it will be a breach. Can you tell us which provision sets out the physical business location? Have you reached that? Mr. Lee, perhaps could take your question. Later, when we come to Clause 8, licensing, we will go into greater detail the licensing requirements. At the moment, we do not have any prescribed premises requirement. We're going to repeal certain requirements. That is to say, we need to have an open business location accessible to the to the general public. This will no longer be set out in the principal ordinance. Is it necessary to put down this phrase, Chairman? What do you mean? Mr. Lee just now said that we are not going to regulate those operating overseas. But what's the point of having the section here? Because, of course, this is local legislation. You cannot regulate those operating outside. The only regulation we have on overseas operations is outbound tours and also those who actively promote their services to the general public in Hong Kong. Even though the operator may be situated in Hong Kong or outside, they may still be required to get a license. Those not within the scope has not been and will not be within our regulation. All clear? Next. Clause 6, subclause 3, circumstances of prohibition in relation to mainland inbound tour group. We were talking about clause 5. We're going to move an amendment as we suggested just now. We're going to use the term mainland inbound tour group travel agent means those who organize mainland inbound tour groups, etc. For the wording in detail, they will be provided to members when we come to the CSA stage. Subclause 4 about offences, that is 6 bracket 4. 6 bracket 3, you're going to move an amendment, yes, about mainland inbound tour group. Can you explain? We're not going to suggest that is a licensed travel agent must not obtain any of the services described in Section 5 for a mainland inbound tour group organized by a person, so on and so forth. We're going to amend the wording similar to the suggestion in Clause 5. That means a person operating and organizing a mainland inbound tour group in the mainland. We will set out in greater detail the person organizing a mainland inbound tour group in the mainland should first be recognized by the State Tourism Bureau. We are talking about Clause 6, Bracket 4, the offences. About contravention of the previous three subsections, it is an offence. And there are two tiers. On conviction on the indictment, to a fine at level 5 and to imprisonment for 2 years, or on summary conviction, to a fine at level 3 and to imprisonment for 6 months. And then about subsection 5, it is a defence for a defendant charged with an offence against subsection 3 to establish that, and then there are two defences available to the defendant. A, all practical steps were taken by the defendant to determine whether the person in the mainland was approved to organize the mainland inbound tour group by a regulatory organization in the mainland that regulates the travel industry of the mainland. Now, we believe since there would be an amendment to the wording, the person in the mainland, a corresponding amendment will also be made here. That is, for a licensed travel agent, if all practical steps were taken to reasonably determine whether the person organizing the mainland inbound tour group is not a travel agent, or that the person or the travel agent was not approved by a regulatory organization in the mainland that regulates the travel industry of the mainland, then a defense would be available to the defendant. And this would be a clarification of the provision. As for 6 bracket 6, the defendant is taken to have established the fact that needs to be established for the defense if, and then A, there is sufficient evidence to raise an issue with respect to that fact, and B, the contrary is not proved by the prosecution beyond reasonable doubt. This is about the prohibitions provisions in Clause 6. Mr. Lee, my question is this. Now, there is a section about regulating mainland inbound tour group. What about the business passing on to the travel agent in Hong Kong? Which provision will capture that? Let's say if a school or if an organization, a school or a labor union passes on to a travel agent here, how would it be regulated? We focus on travel agents organizing mainland inbound tour group in the mainland. And when we communicate with the state authority, we understand that a similar approach is taken in the mainland. For members of a, say, community organization, enterprises, business unit, or schools, they may directly organize an outbound tour group in the mainland. They are not regarded as a travel agent business. Hence, they will not be breaching the relevant travel laws. When we communicated with the industry, we understood that a person in the mainland might be too wide, and we therefore would make an amendment here. For a person in the mainland, we should specify that it is a travel agent organizing a mainland inbound tour group in the mainland, such that only mainland travel agencies would be captured. If a person carries out business which the mainland authorities regard as travel agent business, say a school for an organization, and if there is no formal approval sought from the mainland authority, then it will be captured by the provision here.
Okay, so now we're regulating this mainland agents organizing tours, but from if mainland agents hand over the groups to Hong Kong, then would things go out of control? If there are complaints, how would you deal with that? Because they are groups handed over to or transferred to Hong Kong groups which are not registered. So would it be possible that the tours actually are transferred to a Hong Kong organization? Thank you for your question. I think in our communication with CNTA, we have actually asked them for all the details. For a mainland party, if it's not a travel agent but a social organization, then it can, through the mainland system or through registration as a social group, to inquire about whether they are the legal organizations and not just any groups pretending to be agents arranging for tours to Hong Kong. Therefore, we are stepping up collaboration with CNTA to regulate the tour market. If a group is not registered and neither is it a legal travel agent on the mainland and yet it has transfer the tourist charging zero fee to Hong Kong, then definitely they will be unauthorized and they will be our targets of regulation. All along with CNTA or the Shenzhen Tourism Administration, we have actually discussed a lot with them, and they are aware of the tours that are charging zero fees, and we will maintain close contact with them. So for all the tours handed over to Hong Kong, they have to be transferred or handed over by a registered organization. How can we find that they are registered? The bill would not go into that detail, but later on, the TIA, after it's established, they will come up with some enforcement guidelines and notices in its contacts with the trade. Because the sector wants to ensure that its business partners in the mainland are legal. So it's to the interest of the local trade to find out whether the business partners are legal. So there will be websites or inquiry hotlines or telephone numbers made available, and we will work on the details. After discussions with the CNTA, and the TNA would let the trade know, and everybody can follow the procedures involved to ensure that they are collaborating with legal partners. Thank you. I think that's very important. I think in your paper next time, please elaborate on it. Okay. Now we are on Division 3, licensing. Clause 7 is about application for travel agent license, where it's mentioned that in the bracket 1, if a person intends to carry on travel agent business, he may apply for a travel agent license. And Section 2, an application for travel agent license must be A, made to the authority in the specified form, and B, accompanied by the prescribed fee and any document the authority may require. So that's Clause 7. Clause 8, issue of travel agent license. There are 7 subsections here. Number 1, the authority may, on application, issue a travel agent license to a company, a partnership, or individual carrying on business as a sole proprietor. Number 2, the authority must not issue a travel agent license unless A, the authority is satisfied that the applicant is a company, a partnership, or an individual carrying on business as a sole proprietor. And secondly, the premises in Hong Kong. So we mentioned that we'll move an amendment to this section. So this Roman letter 2 section, subsection will be cancelled. And subsection 3, the applicant is suitable to hold license having regard to matters set out in Division 4. And number 5, the applicant meets the guarantee money requirement and capital requirement. And 6, the applicant meets the authorized representative requirement. And Section 7, the period specified under Subsection 6 must not be longer than 12 months beginning on the day on which the license is issued. Sorry, please stop here. Any questions up to here? You've been quite fast. We need time to digest. No questions? Then let's move on. Clause 9. Application for branch license. As we explained in the paper CB4/4687-18(02), for all the writings on the branch license, we'll move an amendment that is to the effect that all branches that have been licensed, that have been given the licenses, they have to be licensees if they want to carry out business outside of their premises, if they want to carry on travel agent business at any other premises, in addition to the premises specifying the agent license, then they have to apply for a branch license and get approval from the authority. And the licensee must show the license at each premises that are shown to customers. So in Clause 9, we will move amendments. So it may not be called a branch license, but we'll move an amendment. And then Clause 10, again, is related to branch license. So as I just said, we will move an amendment. So that is how can, what sort of requirements the authority can consider, what sorts of information the authority would require for and consider. There will be amendments. For example, like in 10(2), here it says that there could be staffing requirement, 2B Roman letter 3, that on this particular we would cancel this section, that is 2(1). The entire subsection 2, we will cancel them, and the fee concern, of course, will be remained. And 10, subsection 3, about the period, effective period, it actually was taken from the 14-day rule for roadshows or exhibitions requirements, but because we're going to cancel 12B, therefore, bracket 3, subsection 3, will also be cancelled, as in 10(2). And 10, sorry, that is when people organize exhibitions, they need to apply for license, right? And in future, they won't have to apply for license, is that right? Mr. Lee? Yes, that's correct. Because of this requirement on the branch license, in the past, if it's less than 14 days, then there could be an exemption. That's the intention of writing this clause, to offer an exemption. But now, since that the requirement for premises have been relaxed, so for roadshows, exhibitions will continue to follow the past practice, and therefore this particular can be cancelled. So in the future, travel agents in wedding expos or travel expos, if they commission a wedding company, wedding gown company, to introduce their services to customers, and yet the company is not their staff, is that okay? I think, as what I said to Mr. Wu, the most important that the business arrangement is clearly delineated and not held at designated premises. For roadshows, the period concern would not be relevant anymore. So 14-day, less than 14-day rule that used to justify the exemption no longer stands. Yeah, I think this is a good change. And then 10 subsections 4 all the way to 8, including the branch license, the specify form, transferability, the periods, effective periods, and so forth, big validity period. Because of the amendments I just proposed, therefore, we would deal with them again. So on these subsections as well. So this is clause 10, and then clause 11 is about what travel agent license or branch license authorizes, and it talks about the person named in the license to carry on travel agent business at the premises specified in the license. Because it mentions branch license, when we move the amendment later, again, we will make a corresponding change in this clause. Clause 12, refusal to issue travel agent license or branch license. As for the arrangement for the refusal, it really comes from chap 218 bracket section 12. It comprises the following parts. Part 1, if the authority intends to refuse to issue a travel agent license or branch license, it must, by notice in writing given to the applicant, A, notify the applicant of the intention, and B, give reasons for the intentions. And subsection 2, the applicant may, within 7 days after the date of the notice, or a longer period the authority may permit, make representations in writing to the authority as to why the authority should not refuse to issue the travel agent license or branch license. And then subsection 3, if the authority decides not to issue a travel agent license or branch license, it must, by notice in writing given to the applicant within 21 days beginning on the day on which the decision is made, notify the applicant of the decisions, and B, give reasons for the decision. Because here it mentions branch license, so we make corresponding change as well in the writing. Refusal to issue a license. Which department in the authority will handle that? Thank you, Chairman. It will be handled by the licensing department of the authority. Of course, the authority itself, you know, as far as organizational structure, we need to discuss that and decide on that later on. You know, it will be up to the board members of the authority to decide. How about appeals? For appeals, it will be dealt with by an appeal committee. And the committee wouldn't have any members from the authority, so as to ensure that the appeal would be dealt with in a just and fair way. How about the current mechanism? That is, if you refuse to issue a license, what is the appeal mechanism now? There's an AAB committee. That is, if the applicant disagrees and wants to lodge an appeal, he will be told how to contact the AAB to lodge an appeal. Thank you. And then clause 13, application for renewal of travel agent license or branch license. Okay, whenever there's mention of branch, we will make the corresponding change, so I'm not going into detail on that or repeat that again. So there are two subsections here. Bracket 1, a licensed travel agent may apply for the renewal of the travel agent license or branch license concerned. And bracket 2, the application must be made to the authority in the specified form within the period specified in section 1.1 of schedule 1, and be accompanied by the prescribed fee and any document the authority may require.
Clause
14, about renewal of travel agent license or branch license. Several subsections. First, the authority may, on application, renew a travel agent license or branch license. 2, the authority must not renew a travel agent license unless A, the authority is satisfied that, and then 5 conditions. 1, about the premises. As we explained just now, the whole provision will be repealed. And then Roman letter 2, the applicant is suitable to hold the license having regard to the matter set out in division 4. and then we'll explain later. And then Roman letter 3, about the guarantee money requirement set up in division 6. And then number 4, about the requirement of authorized representative. Number 5, staffing requirement. Again, this will be repealed. So 2, 3, and 4 will be kept. 1 and 5 will be repealed. And then B, about renewal of travel agent license, apart from meeting the three conditions, the applicant must have paid the prescribed fee. (3) The authority must not renew a branch license unless A, the applicant holds a valid travel agent license, and B, about the premises and the staffing requirements. Again, these will be repealed or amended. And then C, the applicant has paid the prescribed fee. And then 14(4), a renewed travel agent license or renewed branch license must be in the specified form. 5, well, in the Chinese version, it should be the specified form instead of format. So 14(4), there will be an amendment. (5), a renewed travel agent license or renewed branch license is not transferable. And then (6), the authority may impose on a renewed travel agent license or renewed branch license the conditions, including prescribed conditions, that it considers appropriate. (14)(7), the authority must specify in a renewed travel agent license or renewed branch license the validity period of the license. And then subsection 8, the period specified under subsection 7, and then A and B. A, for a renewed travel agent license, must not be longer than 12 months beginning on the date on which the license is renewed, or B, for a renewed branch license, must not be longer than the validity period of the travel agent license of the applicant. That means other licenses must not be longer than the original license. And then subsection 9, a travel agent license or branch license may be renewed more than once. And that's clause 14 about renewal travel agent license, the consideration, etc. So not much change, just as in the existing approach. Clause 15, refusal to renew travel agent license or branch license. Again, this is modeled on section 15 of cap 218. If the authority intends to refuse to renew a travel agent license or branch license, it must, by notice in writing given to the applicant, A, notify the applicant of the intention, and B, give reasons for the intention. And then 2, the applicant may, within 7 days after the date of notice or longer period the authority may permit, make representations in writing to the authority as to why the authority should not refuse to renew the travel agent license or branch license. Subsection 3, if the authority decides not to renew a travel agent license or branch license, it must, by notice in writing given to the applicant within 21 days beginning on the date on which the decision is made, A, notify the applicant of the decision, and B, give reasons for the decision. And that's about clause 15. Clause 16, no fresh application for travel agent license, etc., within prescribed period after refusal. This is modeled on cap 211, 25(1A, the estate agent's ordinance. 16(1). This section applies to a person whose application for a travel agent license or a branch license or the renewal of a travel agent license or branch license has been refused. And then 2, a person may not reapply for a travel agent license or a branch license or the renewal of a travel agent license or branch license within a prescribed period. And then subsection 3, Despite subsection 2, the authority may permit the person to reapply for a travel agent license or branch license or the renewal of a travel agent license or branch license within the prescribed period if the authority is satisfied that the ground for the refusal no longer exists. And this is about Clause 16, the arrangement after an application has been refused. 17, no fresh application for travel agent license, etc. within prescribed period for after revocation. This is coming from 25.1b of Cap 211 Estate Agents Ordinance. 1. This section applies to a person whose travel agent license or branch license has been revoked. 2. The person may not reapply for a travel agent license or branch license within the prescribed period. 3. Despite subsection 2, the authority may permit the person to reapply for a travel agent license or branch license within the prescribed period if the authority is satisfied that exceptional circumstances exist that justify the permission. So this is about Division 3, licensing. Any questions? I have a question on refusal or revocation, no fresh application for the license should be allowed. There is a prescribed period. Is that the existing practice? Yes. For Cap 218, at the moment, we have a similar requirement. The prescribed period is one of 12 months. After a license application has been refused, no fresh application can be made. So that will be the a continuation of the existing requirement. All right, moving on to Division 4, suitability requirement. Clause 18, suitability requirement for applicant for travel agent license or renewal of travel agent license. Subsection 1. In this section, associated company. In relation to a company means A. A subsidiary of the company, B. A holding company of the company, and C. A subsidiary of the holding company mentioned in paragraph B. So that's the three definitions for associated company. Subsection 2, in determining for the purposes of section 82A3 and 14.2A2 about issuance or renewal of licenses, whether a company is suitable to hold a travel agent license, the authority must have regard to all relevant matters, including those as follows, which are modeled on 12 bracket 2 B to 3 of Cap 218, and they include A, the matter set out in Schedule 2, and B, whether every officer and controller of the company is suitable to be associated with the business of a travel agent, and C, any information in the possession of the authority, whether provided by the company or not, on any matters relating to an associated company of the company, including 1. The matters set out in Schedule 2 and 2, whether every officer and controller of the associated company is suitable to be associated with the business of a travel agent. So these are relevant to determining whether the company is suitable for holding a travel agent license. And that's 18 bracket 2. 18 subsection 3 deals with some partnership arrangement, whether the partnership is suitable to hold a travel agent license. And there are two criteria for consideration modeled on the existing requirement in Cap 218. The requirements are set out in Schedule 3, that's 3A and B, whether every person responsible or proposed to be responsible for the management of the travel agent business of the partnership or any part of the business is suitable to be associated with the business of a travel agent. And that's 18 bracket 3 about partnerships. whether a partnership is suitable to hold a travel agent license. 18(4), whether an individual is suitable to hold a travel agent license. The authority must have regard to all relevant matters, including A, the matter set out in (1) of Schedule 4, and B, whether every person responsible or proposed to be responsible for the management of the travel agent business of the individual or any part of the business is suitable to be associated with the business of a travel agent. And then 18(5), in determining for the purposes of subsections 2B, 3B, and 4B, whether a person is suitable to be associated with the business of a travel agent, the authority must consider A, if a person is a company, have regard to all relevant matters, including the matters set out in Schedule 2, and then B, if the person is a partnership, have regard to all relevant matters, including the matters set out in Schedule 3, and C, if the person is an individual, have regard to all relevant matters, including the matters set out in (1)(1) of Schedule 4. These are the provisions on suitability requirements in Division 4 of the Bill. All right, Division 4, any questions? Yes, legal advisor. Sorry, speaker's not coming through. Thank you, Chairman. I would like to invite the administration to elaborate on suitability because there are provisions that refer to Schedule 2, 3, and 4 in relation to, say, a company, a partnership, and an individual. I think it may be better to brief members on these schedules at this stage. Let's start with Schedule 2. That is C-616, about Section 18 and Section 170. About company matters in Schedule 2, for the purposes of Section 18-2A, about the suitability requirement we just covered, and C-1 and 5A, the matters in relation to a company are, and there are 8 of them, whether the company has entered into a composition or scheme of arrangement with its creditors or has made an assignment of its estate for the benefit of its creditors. B, whether the company is in liquidation or is the subject of a winding up order. C, whether the company has whether a receiver or manager of the company's property has been appointed. D, whether the company has been convicted, whether in Hong Kong or elsewhere, of a criminal offence involving a finding that the company acted fraudulently, corruptly, or dishonestly. E, whether the company has been convicted of a criminal offence under this ordinance. F, whether the company has been convicted of a criminal offence under the Trade Descriptions Ordinance, Cap 362. G, the company's record relating to, and then, 1, any application for a license or the renewal of a license under the repealed ordinance, and 2, any application for a travel agent license or renewal of a travel agent license, and 3, the travel agent business of a licensed travel agent or a person who holds a license under the repealed ordinance, and then H, the 8th requirement, the company's record in complying with 1, the directives, codes of conduct, or any other instruments made by the Travel Industry Council before the repeal of the repealed ordinance, and 2, the requirements in this ordinance. These are the requirements under company matters in Schedule 2.
So for the TIC, you know, directors issued Are you referring to any directives? Any directives issued by TIC will be transferred to TIA, right? Would there be any adjustments when the law takes effect? So you are saying that under the new regulatory system, in considering whether a person is suitable, here it means that it will make a reference to the TIC's under existing regulations, is record of compliance. Of course, under the current legislation, before it's repealed, and when we still have TIC regulating the sector before TIA is established, so all the regulatory work will, based on the current provisions, including the mechanism for appeal, will be continued. So transitioning from TIC to TIA, if doing the process, would there be a line drawn after which the TIA will have total control and all the judgments or penalties imposed by TIC before the line, people applying for 12-month license, they would not be affected, right? Of course, there will be a transitional arrangement made. I think at the last part of the bill about transitional arrangements, you will see the details and there will be elaborations there. But simply put, in considering the suitable person, we will consider the under the previous regulatory system that is under cap 2 and 8, whatever regulation under the repeal chapter, then we will make reference to the records of compliance of the person concerned. As for after line is drawn, that is when TIC is transitioned into TIA, then there will be detailed provisions on the arrangement itself, which will deal with, for example, cases, marginal cases, or there have been only half decided on and so forth, the handover arrangements, there will be details and detailed provisions on that. By the time of clause-by-clause scrutiny, we will elaborate on them. Okay, so Schedule 2 is about company matters. Schedule 3 involves partnership matters. You may refer to this section. It talks about the qualification of a partner. I will go through them one by one. A, under A, it is the matters in relation to partnership are whether any partner in partnership is an undischarged bankrupt, whether any partner in a partnership has entered into a composition or scheme of arrangement with the partner's creditors or has made an assignment of the partner's estate for the benefit of the partner's creditors. C, whether any partner in the partnership is in liquidation or is the subject of a winding up order. And D, whether a receiver or manager of the property of any partner in the partnership has been appointed. E, whether any partner in the partnership is a mentally disordered person or a patient within the meaning of Section 2, Bracket 1 of the Mental Health Ordinance, Cap 136. And F, whether any partner in the partnership has been convicted, whether in Hong Kong or elsewhere, of a criminal offence involving a finding that a partner acted fraudulently, corruptly, or dishonestly. G, whether any partner in a partnership has been convicted of a criminal offence under this ordinance. H, whether any partner in a partnership has been convicted of a criminal offence under the Trade Descriptions Ordinance Cap 362. I, whether any partner in a partnership has been convicted, whether in Hong Kong or elsewhere, of a criminal offence involving violence. J, the record of any partner in the partnership relating to four subsections here, one, and the application for license or the renewal of a license under the repealed ordinance, two, and the application for a tourist guide pass or tour escort pass or renewal, three, and the application for license or renewal of a license, and fourth, the travel agent business of a licensed travel agent or a person who holds a license under the repealed ordinance. K. The record of any partner in a partnership in complying with the following. A. 1. The directives, codes of conduct, and any other instruments made by the Travel Industry Council before the repeal of the repealed ordinance. And 2. The requirements in this ordinance. So this is Schedule 3 about partnership matters. Schedule 4 and then Schedule 4. Clause 1, subsection 1, is about the matters in relation to an individual, or you know, whether the individual is a discharged bankrupt and the qualifications of the individuals. There are 19 items. 1A is whether the individual is an discharged bankrupt. B, whether the individual has entered into a composition or a scheme of arrangement with the individual's creditors or has made an assignment of the individual's estate for the benefit of the individual's creditors. C, whether the individual is a mentally disordered person or a patient within the meaning of Section 2, Bracket 1 of the Mental Health Ordinance, Cap 136. D, whether the individual has been convicted, whether in Hong Kong or elsewhere, of a criminal offence involving a finding that the individual acted fraudulently, corruptly, or dishonestly. E, whether the individual has been convicted of a criminal offence under this ordinance. F, whether the individual has been convicted of a criminal offence under Cap 362 of the Trade Descriptions Ordinance. G, whether the individual has been convicted, whether in Hong Kong or elsewhere, of a criminal offence involving violence. H, the individual's record relating to the following four items. 1, any application for a license or renewal of a license under the repealed ordinance. 2, any application for a tourist guide pass or tour escort pass or renewal. 3, application for license or renewal. 4, travel agent business of a licensed travel agent or person who holds a license under the repealed ordinance. And item I, the individual's record in complying with 1, the directives, codes of conduct and any other instruments made by the Travel Industry Council before the repeal of the repealed ordinance. And secondly, the requirements in this ordinance. We're gonna talk later about the tour guide and tour groups, tour guide and tour escort qualifications. So for the 9 items under the individual, besides 1.1 and 0.2, and also B, where the person has in Hong Kong or elsewhere been convicted of committing a criminal offence, and that offence is related to sex and drugs. So that's the individual requirements. So any questions? We have finished Division 4 and time is almost up. So our next meeting is on February 9th, Friday, 10:45 in the morning. Any questions? If not, then meeting adjourned. Thank you.